Announced on the official website. Each speaker has 10 minutes. Please, can you switch off audio? Thank you. So let me introduce the first speaker, Ramazan Chakmakchi, with presentation inoculation with plant growth promoting bacteria for improving nodulation, nitrogen uptake, and growth of peanut, Arachis hypogea L. Please. Please switch on your audio. Dear Ramazan Chakmakchi, switch on your audio microphone.
Yes.
Okay, değil mi?
Yes, we hear you. Please.
Thank you. My presentation will be on the application on microbial fertilizer, the peanut. I attend the Çanakkale University Faculty Agriculture. I would like to thank you everyone, especially organizer on the organization, of course, to you, dear chairman. Aim of the work was to evaluate effective mineral fertilizer MP to commercial biofertilizer and single doll and three strain combination with auxin producing, nitrogen fixing, phosphate solubilizing and amino cyclopropan carboxylate deaminase containing bacteria.
Ramazan hocam şu an sizin sunumunuzu göremiyoruz ama eğer paylaşabilirseniz şehir screen alanında tıklarsanız ortada yeşil.
Nerede?
Senin hocam
zoom'u
açın.
Nerede
zoom? Açın bunu. Tam ekran.
Açılmıyor ki orası.
Şehir screen alanı var.
Nerede? Bak. Bunun nereye gittiğini anlamadım ki.
Pardon hocam alabilir miyim?
Çok çok çok. O onu açarken başka bir yere mi gitti yoksa? Hı?
Şu an sohbeti göremiyorum. Şuradan full screen şey paylaşımı açın. Ekran paylaşımınızı açın.
Hı-hı. Tamam.
Slide seçin.
Düştük. Şey.
Şey.
Yanlış yere düştük.
Şimdi tam ekran oldu.
Tam yapınca.
Evet oldu hocam.
Okay.
Evet hocam.
Excuse me. Excuse me.
Şimdi bir dakika.
The aim of the work, my work, was to evaluate the effect of mineral fertilizer, MP and MP, to commercial biofertilizer, single do and three strain combination, IEE producing, nitrogen fixing, phosphate solubilizing, and one amino cyclopropan carboxylate deamines containing bacteria on nodulation, nitrogen uptake, and growth of peanut. Peanut is one of the important annual self-pollinating indeterminate and summer oil and chess crop. Belong to the legume family, grown in tropical, semi-arid to tropical temperate zone and warm temperature region. Most grown because the oil, protein, carbohydrate, part of can be used for food, propose animal feed, industry, raw material. It varies according to variety. Seed contain oil, protein, carbohydrate, mineral element, as well as vitamin. Microorganisms are important in agriculture in order to promote circulation of plant nutrients and reduce the need for chemical fertilizer as much as possible. In generally, beneficial free-living nitrogen fixing and phosphate solubilizing bacteria are usually referred to as plant growth promoting rhizobacteria, PGPR. Use of PGPR has great impact on rot biology, influence plant growth, nutrition, and development, important for long-term sustainability. And play important role plant nutrition through increased nitrogen, phosphate, and other nutrients. In that case, chemical fertilizer use problem, consume fossil fuel reserve, increase greenhouse gas, polluting groundwater, change nitrogen cycle, find resource, increase phosphate shortage, and finally, causes environmental problems. Current intensive agriculture uses too much energy. This system is not sustainable and has become one pollution sector. This is not sustainable agriculture system. This entire risk, excessive fertilization, and sustainable agriculture system require use of biofertilizer. Apart from the fixing nitrogen, free living plant growth promoting rhizobacteria affect growth directly, synthesis of phytohormone, regulation, production, phytohormone and siderophore, promoting beneficial plant microbial association, inhibition plant ethylene synthesis, enhance the stress resistance, enhance nutrient uptake, solubilization, inorganic phosphate, and mineralization of organic phosphate and other could enhance activity of antioxidant oxidative pentose phosphate pathway enzyme and activity of enzyme ACC carboxylate deaminase. Biofertilizer safe for water source, not cause depletion, fossil fuel, protect natural resource, environmental quality. Also, plant growth promoting due to addition, PGPR include increased germination rate, shoot and root growth, yield, leaf array, chlorophyll content, nitrogen content, protein content, tolerance, drug, and delay of senescence. My field experiment has been conducted under the main crop condition at the research experimental field, Bachem. The present study, effect of mineral fertilizer, nitrogen plus phosphate, two commercial liquid biofertilizer, indole acetic acid producing, ACC deaminase containing, nitrogen fixing, phosphate solubilizing bacteria, Besset biofertilizer, single Pseudomonas fluorescens, Bacillus subtilis, Bacillus megatherium. Dual triple strain combination on the different growth parameter of peanut, big of root, shoot, total biomass, number and dry weight nodule per plant. Dry-wege per nodule nitrogen content of nodule single randomize desen my real single inoculation, dual inoculation, triple inoculation, commercial liquid biofertilizer Vita, commercial liquid biofertilizer Green, two chemical fertilizer, nitrogen plus phosphate and phosphate as well as controlled treatment without inoculation, any fertilizer application. The bacterial inoculation organic liquid carrier was incubated with bioreactor growth optimum condition. Weeds were controlled by hand. There was no disease insect attack on the growth cycle. Sprinkler irrigation was applied and ensured germination after sowing, maintains point by irrigation were done time. Data on different growth parameter, P node, growth and nodulation parameters. Result, bacterial inoculation, mineral fertilizer and biofertilizer formulation stimulated overall plant growth nodulation and nitrogen content, including wet root shoot, total biomass, number and dry weight of nodule per plant. Dry weight per nodule, nitrogen content of nodule, root shoot, peanut plant. In generally, single inoculation performed better than uninoculated control. Dual inoculation than single and co-inoculation, all of three organisms performed better than both single and double inoculation in terms of growth, nitrogen and nodulation parameters. Field trials show bacterial formulation, commercial liquid biofertilizer and inorganic fertilizing applications significantly affect parameter investigated, nodulation, nitrogen uptake, growth of peanut, but depend on the strain combination and evaluated parameters compared to the control. All treatment tested increased dry weight per nodule virus, only the nitrogen and plus phosphate fertilizer, inoculation of triple strain combination and commercial liquid biofertilizer increased the percent of the nitrogen content and root and wall ground in the peanut plant. Inoculation multi-trait PGPR has synergistic effect on the peanut growth, significantly improved shoot root weight nodule number, indole acetic acid production by PGPR might be stimulated, lateral rot formation, root weight increased, nodulation growth not plant. This is show my tablet. Most effective treatment, nitrogen plus phosphate, triple strain combination, and commercial liquid biofertilizer growth parameters on peanut shelf. After then, nodule number, nodule dry weight, nodule fresh weight, milligram per nodule, root nitrogen content and above ground nitrogen content show the table. All treatment increased nodule drain weight. Expect risky Bacillus megatherium. All treatment increased nodule number per plant. Also, root nitrogen content only increased mineral fertilizer and triple strain combination and or mixture combination and also nodule nitrogen content increased dual triple strain combination inoculation and chemical fertilizer application, but not a single inoculation. Root nitrogen content milligram per plant increased all treatment. Completion. The effect of free living and non-rhizobial PGPR inoculation PNUT mechanism which improving nitrogen fixation should be adequately investigated when Pseudomonas fluorescens, Bacillus subtilis, Bacillus megatherium inoculated in PNUT, they significantly improve plant growth, nodulation, nitrogen uptake, nitrogen component in their single and dual inoculation. Particularly, why the use of non-symbiotic indole acetic acid producing ICC diaminesic producing nitrogen fixing phosphate solubilizing and solubilizing and mobilizing microorganism as biofertilizer, increasing promoting nitrogen and phosphate uptake, nodule formation and function with phosphate dissolving bacteria in legume is important area of the study for developing strategy effective management of plant nutrients. Show the picture end of the experiment, not flowering fish. Most effective treatment show triple combination left and nitrogen plus phosphate fertilizer. After then, dual inoculation, Pseudomonas fluorescens and Bacillus subtilis. Also show the picture, all treatment end of the experiment. Show the picture, PNUT nodulation, effect of the inoculation. For example, dual inoculation, Bacillus subtilis, plus Pseudomonas fluorescens. Also, triple strain combination showed left side nodulation. Very, very excellent for me. Also, other picture, nitrogen plus phosphate and commercial fertilizer also. Not mineral fertilizer formulation, dual formulation, triple formulation, Thank you for your attention. The use of PGPR agriculture for me will become more important in the future. Thank you for Sharman.
Thank you a lot, dear Ramazan Cakmaçi, for representation your researches. Next, please, Haydar Kuplinyas will represent the researches investigation of volatile oil components of Savlia glutinosa. Please.
Thank you. Now I am updating the.
Dear Ramazan, please stop presentation of your screen.
Yes, stop. Bir dakika.
Ramazan Cakmaçi, you switched off your camera, but you didn't stop demonstration of your screen. So please stop demonstration of screen. Oh, thank you.
No, I am trying to upload to PowerPoint. Please give me a minute. Yes. Can you see the PowerPoint?
No. Yes. Everything is okay.
Can I start?
Yes, please. We are waiting for your Thank presentation. You.
Dear participants, I would like to present our study today. We are connecting from Recep Tayyip Erdoğan University Faculty of Agriculture from the Field Crop Department. Usually our work areas are medicinal plants and also their in vitro regeneration and their essential oil components, secondary metabolites. The title of our study, Investigation of Volatile Oil Component of Salvia glutinosa. The Eastern Black Sea region has an important place in terms of plant species, especially medicinal and high commercial value species among these plants requires attention to the plants of the region and especially the plants belonging to the Lamiasa family. Also species of Lamiasa family used in folk medicine in the region, apart from being used in industry. In addition, it is used as raw drug in the form of condiments and species increases its importance even more. As you can see here, the map of Eastern Black Sea when compared in map of Turkey. Usually the Eastern Black Sea region is widely known as it is high altitude mountains, and those mountains and high humidity levels in air make this area very special with the especially for medicinal plants. There are 222 endemic species among the 2,239 plant species in the Black Sea region. The medicinal and commercial uses of these plants, which are the subject of this study, are increasing day by day. Especially the essential oil they contain and the enlightenment of the secondary metabolites in the essential oils have increased the importance of these plants. Essential oils are usually complex mixtures of natural compounds of both polar and apolar structure and consist mainly of terpenoids and their oxygenated derivatives. Essential oils which have antioxidant and antimicrobial activities have therapeutic properties and are the raw materials of cosmetics as well as acting as natural additives in foods and food products. Usually the medicinal plants are not only as, you know, herbal teas, but also are very important plants in the industry. There are about 900 species of sage. We mean sage as in Latin salvia. Salvia is genus name in the world. The species are the most mostly distributed in Americas. Americas mean North, Central, and the South Americas, and the Southwest Asia continents. There are 97 salvia species in Turkey, and 51 of these species are endemic and show a high rate of endemism. Many salvia species exhibit some medicinal effects, such as antispasmodic, it is usually effects on muscles, antibacterial, antifungal, and antioxidant activity. Moreover, many of salvia species are used to flower food as well as in cosmetics, perfumes, and other pharmaceutical industries, especially for their essential oil contents. Salvia glutinosa naturally grows in moist locations in deciduous forest and shrub in PSC forest of South and South Anatolia, and it is North and South, sorry for the mistake, North and South of Anatolia, and the flowering time is July to October. North of Turkey, especially the Black Sea region, has a very high humidity in the air, and Salvia glutinosa is one of the species of Eastern Black Sea region. In this study, the volatile components of the Salvia glutinosa, we mean essential oils as volatile. They are synonyms. Volatile components or essential oil components are synonym words, so they mean same. Salvia glutinosa plants were investigated, which collected from the Chad Plateau and could cultivated from the field in the Rize at the time of flowering. Material method section. This experiment was conducted at Faculty of Agriculture, Recep Tayyip Erdoğan University in 2021. The plant materials were collected from the Chad Plateau in 1,295 meter altitude, plateau in Rize, Turkey. Cultivated types were harvested. Were harvested on plots located in the trial area of the Faculty of Agriculture, Recep Tayyip Erdoğan University. The aerial parts, we mean as aerial parts above on the soil. So we just don't take the root of the plants, but plant parts above of the soil, usually called as aerial parts in medicinal plants area of research. Salvia glutinosa were collected at the time of flowering and used as plant material. The plants were cut at a height of 10 to 15 centimeters above the soil level, and the flower parts were separated. Dried plant samples weighted 100 gram and distillated with neocolaventure apparatus. The essential oil content in herb was calculated as the volume of essential oil in 100 grams of dry sample. In order to determine essential oil components, Shimasu module GCMS present in Recep Tayyip Erdoğan University Faculty of Agriculture Plant Analysis Laboratory was used. CPMA, so solid phase microextraction method, was used to determine the essential oil components. Analysis results were evaluated and reported using related library. Results and discussion section. Almost 28 different components were found as a result of the analysis, while made up as a significant part of the featured components. The significant part of the prominent volatile components in the plant samples collected from the nature was found as respectively germ occurrence D, as 15.87%. Neomethyl acetate was found as 8.2%. Neodine also was a main volatile oil component, and isoborneol, alpha hemacylline, isovaleric acid, and carvacrol was the main components, the plants which was taken from the Chad plateau. And the other plants, the cultivated time, we grow them in our field trial area in our university, and some growing technique packet was created. Volatile oil compounds of the plant samples cultivated from the field was found as germacrin D, aromadendrin, neomethyl acetate, alpha hemacylline, beta bourbeon, alpha humulin, and theta cadinan. It is, I think, interesting thing that germacrin D amounts was same in the both types, in flora and the culture type, as 15.87%. And also neomethyl acetate amount was also same as 8.2. Sorry. As you can see in figure 2, essential oil contents of flora F culture compared in a graphic bar. The blue one is flora type and the gray one is culture type. Some of the essential oil components differ from themselves in flora and culture. For example, the aromadendrin, beta bourbeon, and alpha humulin distinguished from the flora type because they just found in culture type. And also neodine, isoborneol, isovaleric acid, and carvacrol was just only found in flora, so it is distinguished from the culture type. We think that altitude, growing techniques, and humidity levels, we can sum up just the climate conditions and the other different conditions cause this. And germacrin D levels was same, and also neomethyl acetate levels was same. Just aromadendrin was an interesting result for us in the culture type. Germacrin D content found interestingly quite identical, as I said before. Also, neomethyl acetate contents were also identical in flora and culture samples. Cultured salvia glutinosa results distinguished from flora with presence of aromadendrin as 13.85%, also beta bourbeon and alpha humulin components. Also, flora type salvia glutinosa results distinguished from the culture type with presence of neodine, isoborneol, isovaleric acid, and carvacrol. There is the soil analysis of our field trial area in our university. The texture of the soil widely contains a clay type, class C, also sand and silt. pH is 5.34. The soil is saltless, as usual in Black Eastern Sea region. Just the phosphorus was poor in the present in soil. Also, potassium was enough in the soil. These results are agreement with Tavassoli. Researchers reported that germacrin D content was as 18%. These results reveal that different climate and soil conditions affect essential oil components even in same species. Chemical differentials within the same species can occur generally as a result of the varied ecological or geographic origin, as well as the generative differential, collecting time, climate, or the method of analysis. Also, germicrine D and neomethyl acetate, I think we can say has a great value because, you know, the pandemic made people interested in the medicinal plants. Also, salvia species are known as antibacterial, antimicrobial, antiviral effects. These essential oil components, so we can call it phytochemicals, are very important both in the folk medicine and for the industry. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any question, I'm interested in hearing, listening to you. Thank you.
Thank you, dear Haydar. In the end of our session, there will be a discussion. And so let me please introduce the next our speaker, Gulbanu Kimace, with a presentation of results of research, identification of some quantitative tomato genotypes by morphological and molecular methods. Please.
Can I stop the share?
Yes, of course. You can stop sharing.
Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. Please, Gulbanu Kimace. You need to switch on your audio, and in the bottom, in the center of your screen, in the bottom, there is a screen sharing.
Share screen alanından yapacaksınız.
Sesi kapattı, sesini açsın. Sesini sanki sen açabilirim.
Gülbanu Hocam, share screen alanı var ya, oraya tıklayın. Sesinizi de açarsanız, sesiniz gelmiyor şu an bize.
We can see your screen.
Selçuk University Faculty of Agriculture Department of Horticulture. Gülbanu Kıymacı. Identification of some qualitative tomato genotypes by morphologic and molecular methods. Tomato is a perennial plant belonging to the family of eggplants. Although it is homologous in South and Central America, it has become the most widely consumed vegetable, spice spreading from Europe to Africa and all over the world. The main reasons why tomatoes are so much consumed all over the world are the positive effects on humans' healthy, the variety of consumption patterns and their compatibility with the world cuisine. According to FAO data for 2019, for tomato production has been reported as approximately 180 million tons. Turkey has a production of approximately 13 million tons, ranks 3 in the world. The aim of study. In our study, it was aimed to determine some characteristics of existing tomato genotypes by morphological and molecular methods and to test their usability in breeding programs. As a result of this study, we aim to develop qualified varieties that are thought to contribute to country's economy in the future to create large gain pool and to determine the relationships between these measurements and observations with the morphologic measurements and observation obtained. Material and method. 240 genotypes in 32 grams obtained by the extraction of competitive varieties belonging to PsychoRG company and available in the market, and 335 genotypes in 33 grams obtained by selection a single plant from them, consistent of the plant material of the study. In addition, 92 genotypes found to be promising in the cycling three level were used as plant material in molecular studies. Morphologic descriptions of 240 genotypes in the cycling three level and 335 genotypes in the cycling three level were met according to determinant of all parameters. The examples were taken for DNA isolation from selecting plants in the cycling three stage and stored it at 20 centigrade derece. DNA isolation from tomato leaf to see simple samples was performed using DNA's plant minikit. Screening for resistance to disease and pesticides. The list of parameters used to determine resistance to tomato mosaic virus, tomato spotlight virus, verticillium dahlia, fusarium oxyporium, melanesia is given in the table. Parameters to be used to determine the resistance levels of genotypes against mentioned diseases. PCR was performed from DNA samples taken from tomato leaves using the SSI marker developed by Chirisi. The fluoride mixture was prepared for each sample to be tested by PCR. PCR reaction mixture. Total reaction volumes were 20 microliters. SSR markers amplified from DNA samples of these tomato genetics were visualized by fragment analysis capillary electrophore system. Results, morphologic measurements and observation results of genotypes in cycling two level. Group tip-top determinant in three genotypes. Indeterminant in 237. Leaf stance subvertical in 41 genotypes, horizontal in 102 stupendous in 71, leaf lunges short in 4 genotypes, moderata in 62, tall in 174, leaf white narrow in 50, 4 genotypes, medium in 100, broad in 86. Fruit color picked in 250 genotypes, light pink in 11, light rind 200, right in 160-50 genotypes, dark rind in 18 genotypes. Fruit maturity time, medium for 60 genotypes, light for 18-8 genotypes, blood for 18-2 genotypes, prematur for 10 genotypes. Fruit longitudinal cross-section, palatinate in 32 genotypes, slightly palatinate 106, shapers in 66, 30 shapers in 31 genotypes, always in 4 genotypes. Other fruit proportion, average fruit weight 244, average fruit width 59 millimeter, fruit light 66 millimeter, mean pericarp thickness 7 millimeter, mean SHKM 4 grit. Loading plot graph was created by using PC1 and PC2 components, which were created as a result of PCA, much from fluid characteristics of genotypes in sapphic 2 level. When the growth is examined, it's seen that there is a symptom positive relationship between fluid size and average carpal number. This is not negative, the relationship was point between the time of fluid maturity and the amount of water fluid 3 matter. It was also created the score plot graph from PC1 and PC2 obtained by PCA result. When the growth is examined, genotypes 243, 40, 147, 100, 126, 122, 300, 91, 118, 71, 100, 30, 140, 100, 140, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, 100, result of phenotypes in selfing 3 selfing three level. Color in purines, pink in 20 genotypes, light pink in 7 genotypes, light bright in 24 genotypes, bright in 270 genotypes, dark green in 14. Breed cross-section, bright in 107 genotypes, not bright in 228 genotypes. Other breed proportion, average breed white, 159 grams, average for it white 16.8 millimetre, mean pericarp thickness 6 millimetre, TCKM mean 40 bx. Loading plot group was created by using PJ1 and PJ2 components, which were created as a result of PJR net. And meet from fluid characteristics of 250 genotypes in selfing 3 level. When the growth is examined, it is seen that there is a strong positive relationship between fluid white and average fluid white. The strongest negative relationship was found between the number of carpels and the longitudinal section of the fluid. When the growth is examined, the fluid characteristics of the tomata are located at the positive intersection of the both components. Molecular results. 92 tomato genotypes, which were thought to be promising among 350 tomato genotypes in selfing 3 level, which were evaluated morphologically, were examined. As a result, 137 SSR alleles were obtained. The mean peak value of the SSR marker used in the study is 0.49, highest spike value 0.4096, lowest peak value 0.4187. The molecular genetic diversity among the tomato genetics used in the study was determined in the dendrogram created is given below. The Neger dendrogram shows that the tomato genetics are divided into four main branches and clustered in six groups. According to dendrogram format, there are 14 genotypes in group A, 3 in group B, 7 in group 17 in group C, 17 in group D, 14 in group E, and 17 in group B. The mean dissimilarity value between genotypes was 0.138, and these results indicate that the molecular genetic diversity among the analyzed genotypes was not high. Resistance studies of genotype 2 meningitis 42 resistant, 37 sensitive, 36 heterozygous. Resistant studies of genotype tomato mosaic virus 18 resistant 19 heterozygote resistant studies of genotype verticillium dahlia. Resistant studies of genotype Fusarium oxyparium. Resistant studies of genotype tomato spot-like virus. For resistant. Resistant studies of genotype tomato yellow leaf curl virus. As a result, the existence of genotypes white resistance can against diseases tests which considered important problems in tomato cultivation, which has a large production area in the production amount in the world in, is a valuable study for breeding. In that study, a large number of genotypes bring resistance gains against some diseases, causing loss of yield and quality in tomato were determined. In the light of the, these data, available gain theory containing resistance, different diseases, and pesticide factor has been established, and new breeding studies will be planned with these materials. Thank you.
Thank you a lot for the results of your presentation. Next, please, Said Bilgi Duran will present research of his results of his researches on the theme COVID-19 epidemic and effect of livestock sector in Turkey. Please, Said.
Hello, everybody. Sorry, I opened the share. Okay, I think so. May I start?
Yes, please. We're waiting. Ah. Your
speech. Dear President and distinguished participant, I apologize for preparing the presentation in Turkish. Agent, again, apologies this. COVID-19 epidemic and effect on livestock sector in Turkey. My presentation language is Turkish. I apologize all participants. My name is Said Bilgin Turan. I'm working in Isparta Provincial Directorate in the Ministry of Agriculture and Forestry. And I will Türkçe olarak devam edeceğim sunumuma. COVID-19 sektöründe, hayvancılık sektöründe özellikle Türkiye genelinde bakanlığımızın bu süreçte etkilendiğini ve hayvancılık sektöründe oluşan bazı aksaklıklarla ilgili bir makale hazırladık. Salgın hastalıklar tarih boyunca ortaya çıkan çok sayıda medeniyet ve ülkenin yok olmasına ve kültürel göçlerin ortaya çıkmasına sebep olmaktadır. Yeni koronavirüs hastalığı özellikle Çin'in Wuhan eyaletinde Aralık ayı sonlarında solunum yoluyla ilgili bazı hastalıkların araştırılması üzerine çıkmış. Wuhan başta olmak üzere Çin Halk Cumhuriyeti ve diğer eyaletlerde yayılarak dünya genelinde bir pandemiye sebep olmuştur. Koronavirüs hayvanlarda ve insanlarda hastalığın neden olabileceği büyük bir virüs ailesidir. İnsanlarda birkaç koronavirüs soğuk algınlığı, MERS ve SARS gibi çeşitli şiddetli akut solunum yolu enfeksiyonlarına neden olmaktadır. Ve bu daha öncelerde de bilinmekteydi. Fakat yeni koronavirüs hastalığı SARS-CoV-2 virüsü uğradığı çeşitli mutasyonlarla daha etkin hale gelmiştir. Mayıs 2020 itibariyle dünya çapında 4 milyonun üzerinde vaka ve 270 binin üzerinde ölüm olayı gerçekleşmiştir. Yani bu Mersin diğer virüslerle kıyaslandığında %6.97 oranında ölüm oranı meydana getirdiği ve çok tehlikeli bir virüs olduğu göze çarpmaktadır. Dünya çapında 240 ülkeye yayılmış, özellikle Amerika Birleşik Devletleri için Brezilya ve Avrupa Birliği ülkelerinde yoğun olarak hastalık gözlemlenmiştir. 2021'in sonlarına yaklaştığımız şu günlerde de ülkemizde yaklaşık olarak 25-30 bin yeni vaka tespit edilmiş ve ölüm oranları da 250 ile 300 arasında değişerek devam etmiştir. Dünyada yaklaşık 570 milyondan fazla tarım çiftliği ve en az 500 milyon aile işletmecisi bulunmaktadır. Dünya çiftliklerinde 10'da 9'u aile işletmeleri şeklinde oluşturulmuştur. Aile işletmelerinin dünya tarım üretiminde %80'ini sağlamaktadır. Yaklaşık 3 milyon tarım işletmesinin 3'te 2'sinden fazlası, yani 10'la 100 dekar arasında genişliği araziye sahiptir. Yaklaşık 1000 dekar ve üzeri sahip işletmelerin payı %15 civarındadır. Türkiye'de kırsal nüfus kentleşmenin artmasıyla sürekli bir azalış göstermektedir. Bu son 20 yılda daha da artmış durumdadır. Bu durum tarımla uğraşan nüfusun azalmasına ve doğal olarak tarım sektörünün istihdamına düşmesine sebep olmaktadır. Türkiye'de tarımsal üretim küçük arazilerde, bölünmüş parsellerde, aile işletmeciliği tarzında ve mülk topraklarında yapılmaktadır. Türkiye'nin yüzölçümü 78 milyon hektardır. Tarım alanları Türkiye yüzölçümünün yaklaşık 3'te 1'i kadardır. Toplam tarım alanlarının da %10'unda sadece sulu tarım yapılabilmektedir. Kırsal nüfusun yıllara göre değişimi 90'lı yıllardan itibaren 2019 yılına kadar yaklaşık %22.7'den %8.7 seviyelerine gerilediğini görmekteyiz. Bununla beraber tabii kırsalda çalışacak nüfus da hızla azaldığı için buna bağlı olarak arazilerimizde boşluklar oluşmaktadır. Araziler boş kalmaktadır. Türkiye'deki aktif nüfusun sektörlere göre dağılışına baktığımızda yaklaşık sektörlerin 90'lı yılların başında tarım sektörü %53.7'si tarım sektöründe çalışmaktayken sanayi ve hizmet kollarında daha az çalışanlarımız mevcuttu. 2019'a 2020 yıllarına geldiğimizde tarım sektöründe %17 istihdam, sanayi sektöründe yaklaşık %19.9 ve hizmet sektöründe %63.10 oranında bir istihdam dağılışı olduğunu gözlemlemekteyiz. Yani yine bu 20 yıllık 30 yıllık süreç içerisinde tarım sektöründen sanayi ve hizmet sektörüne doğru yoğun bir yöneliş olduğu göze çarpmaktadır. Yine hayvan varlığımızda buna karşılık yine 90'lı yıllardaki rakamlarla 2019 yıllarını rakamları karşılaştırdığımızda hayvan sayımızda son yıllarda son 10 yılda müthiş bir artış olduğu göze çarpmaktadır. Özellikle küçükbaş hayvancılığımızda meydana gelen anormal azalmanın 2020 yılında yaklaşık 53 milyona ulaşarak eski canlılığını kazandığını görmekteyiz. Tabloda tekrar dikkatimizi çeken şey 90'lı yıllardan 2019 yılına kadar, yani salgın öncesi döneme kadar hayvan sayılarımızın arttığı ve 2019-2020 sürecinde de baktığımızda tekrar hayvan sayılarında çok önemli bir değişiklik olmadığını görmekteyiz. Yine süt üretimimiz 2002 yılından 2019 yılına kadar ciddi bir artış gerçekleşmiş. İki katından fazla bir artış olduğunu görmekteyiz. Özellikle sığır sütü üretiminde çok ciddi artış kaydedilmiş. Bu artış özellikle gıda sanayisinde peynir, pastörize süt ürünlerinin üretiminde artış meydana getirmiştir. Yani bu artışın olması bizi özellikle COVID-19 salgını döneminde ülkemizin hayvancılık konusunda, hayvan ve hayvansal ürünler konusunda kendi kendine yeter bir ülke olduğunu göstermiş ve dışarı gıda sektörünün özellikle hayvansal ürünlerde çok bir etkisini görmedik 2019-2020'deki salgın döneminde. Covid-19 salgında hayvancılık işletmeleri yine 2020 yılında başlayan Covid-19 salgını ile birlikte Türkiye'de hayvancılık işletmelerine gerekli tedbirler hem Tarım Orman Bakanlığı hem de işletme sahiplerince alınmıştır. Bu tedbirler mevsimlik tarım işçilerinin çalışmaya devam edebilmesi için alınan tedbirler, yem bitkilerinin ekilişleri, yem ham maddelerinin sağlanması için alınan tedbirler, tedarik zincirindeki market ve gıda sanayindeki üretimin devam etmesi için alınan tedbirler başlıklarında alınmış ve sektörün özellikle gıda sürecini yakından ilgilendiren tarım ve hayvancılık sektörlerinde üretimin aksamadan devam etmesi sağlanmıştır. Ülkemizde hayvancılık işletmeleri konusunda gerek işçilik gerekse ham madde temininde ciddi sorunlar yaşanmamıştır. Bunda ülkemizin ve hükümetimizin almış olduğu yerinde ve hızlı tedbirlerin olası sıkıntılarının önüne geçilmiştir. Salgın döneminde tarımsal üretim yapan ve hayvancılıkla uğraşan sektörler pandemi yasaklarından muaf tutularak oluşabilecek bir gıda krizinin önüne geçilmiştir. Yani bu dönemlerde hepimiz hatırlarız. Özellikle tarım ve hayvancılıkla uğraşan kişilerin bütün bu pandemi yasaklarından muaf olması sağlanmış ve üretime devam etmelerine katkıda bulunmuştur böylelikle. Tabii burada restoran ve otellerin kapalı olması, turizm sezonunda yasakların olması nedeniyle tüketimde daralmalar meydana gelmiştir. Fakat bu daralmalar üreticilerin ürünlerini satmasında ciddi bir soruna neden olmamış, ülke içinde tüketim üretimi karşılamıştır. Ancak ithalata bağımlı olduğumuz yağlı tohumlar, kimyevi gübre, mısır, soya gibi ürünlerde yaşanan artışlar ve ilgili ülkelerin yasakları sonucunda bu piyasalarda anormal fiyat dalgalanmaları görülmüştür. Üretim maliyetlerinin artmasıyla süt ürünlerinde fiyat artışına gidilmiştir. Tabii burada salgın dönemini ele aldık. Salgın esas sıkıntımız salgından sonra bizi bekleyen tehlikeler. Özellikle kimyevi gübre fiyatlarındaki artışlar 2019-2021 döneminde yaklaşık %100, %120 oranında kimyevi gübre fiyatlarında bir artış gerçekleşti. Yine dünya ve ülkemizde enerji fiyatlarının artması, 2019-2020 21 yıllarında %80, %90 oranında bu artış göstermiş. Yem ham madde fiyatlarındaki artışın devam etmesi yine %50, %60 bandında ve daha yüksek seviyelerde bu devam etmektedir. Yani artı zincir marketlerin fiyat politikaları, kuraklık ve iklimin etkisi, ciddi şekilde yetiştiricilerin üretim sektöründen çekilmesi ve gıda krizini tetiklemiş görünmektedir. Tabii bununla ilgili bazı yapılması gerekenlere de kısaca bir göz atmak istiyoruz. Yani bununla ilgili bakanlıklar, yetiştiriciler, sivil toplum örgütleri, üniversite ve araştırma enstitüleri bunun sac ayağını oluşturmakta. İlgili bakanlıklar dediğimizde başta Tarım Orman Bakanlığı ve Ticaret Bakanlığı gelmekte. Tarım Orman Bakanlığı sübvansiyonlarla üretim maliyetlerinin düşürülmesi ve yetiştiricilerin korunmasını sağlamak ve kooperatifleri güçlendirerek oluşabilecek gıda krizinin önüne geçmesini sağlamak zorundadır. Ticaret Bakanlığı özellikle piyasa, üretim ve tüketim fiyatlarını kontrol ederek üreticilerin ve son tüketicilerin korunmasıyla görevli ve bununla ilgili mevzuat çalışmalarını yapması gerekmektedir. Yetiştiriciler özellikle büyükbaş hayvan ve küçükbaş hayvan yetiştiriciler üretim maliyetlerini azaltıcı tedbirler alarak üretimin verimliliğini artırmak zorundadır. Çünkü birim maliyetler arttığı için daha düzgün çalışmalarla, yani düzgün işte besleme, hijyen ve diğer kurallara uyarak ürün verimliliğini arttırmaları gerekmektedir. Yani yine sivil toplum örgütleri bunlar üretici ve tüketicinin bilinçlendirilmesi, sorunların ilgili kurumlara aktarılmasında mesela ziraat odaları, yetiştirici birlikleri önemli rol oynamaları gerekmekte. Yine üniversite ve araştırma enstitüleri yeni alternatif yem ham maddeleri, özellikle kimyevi gübreler, çeşitli soya ve mısır türlerindeki çalışmalarıyla ülkemizde üretilebilirliğini artırarak dışa bağımlılığını azaltarak gerekli çalışmaları yapması gerekmektedir. Sonuç olarak yaşanan COVID-19 salgında gıda üretiminin ne kadar önemli olduğunu bir kez daha göstermiştir. Ülkemizde tarım hayvancılığın alınan tedbirler kapsamında sürdürülebilir olması ile bu dönemde hiçbir sorun yaşamadık. Ancak salgın döneminde maliyetlerin çok fazla artması, üreticinin giderlerini karşılayamaz ve üretim yapamaz hale gelmiş olmaları, dışarıya bağımlı olduğumuz ham madde, kimyevi gübre tedariğinde yaşanan sorunlar üretim maliyetlerini ciddi olarak artırmıştır. Dünya genelinde ülkemizde de ortaya çıkan gıda krizini en az zararla atlatmak için yetiştiriciler ve üreticiler mutlaka pozitif ayrımcılık ile korunması önem arz etmektedir. Tarım politikalarının kesinlikle gözden geçirilmesi, kooperatifler kanununun yenilenmesi ve güncellenmesi bu konuda yapılacak işlerin başında gelmektedir. Hepinize çok teşekkür ediyorum beni dinlediğiniz için. Thank you for attention and thank you very much.
Thank you a lot for your presentation. Please, next our speaker is Abdinasir Mohamud with the presentation Somali agriculture and livestock nomadic production. Please, Abdinasir, we are waiting.
Thank you. Can you see the PowerPoint?
Yes, we will see your presentation.
Thank you. Hello everybody. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for giving this opportunity first to introduce myself. My name is Abdinasir. I'm from Somalia. Now I'm studying master's degree of livestock economy and management for Selçuk University. And after that, I'm going to give a short presentation in this conference. And the topic of presentation is in Somali agricultural and livestock nomadic production. So let's start our presentation. Introduction. And environment of in the environment of Somalia. And the Somalia and the Republic of Somalia is located in the east of Africa continent. It has borders with Ethiopia, Kenya, Djibouti. Somalia has an area approximately in 638,000 kilometers square and has a coastline approximately 3,333 kilometers. The altitude increased precipitation increasing on some of the areas in the western part of the Swiss as much as in 20 inches of precipitation by year, equal 9 kilogram. And we're gonna talk about the rain seasons in East Africa. It's divided into two district seasons. Long rain is from April to June. We're gonna call Ngu. And it is generally account for more than 60% of annual precipitation. Short precipitation occurs between September and November. North of Somalia is usually colder, and the average monthly temperature change is around 15 to 25 degrees centigrade, and is the south around 25 to 35 degrees centigrade. We're going to talk about geographical features in Somalia. How is the geographical season, geographical features in Somalia? Nomadic animals has pandas, which is the most suitable for livestock activity for the territory of Somalia. It's carried up depending on arid and semi-arid pastoral in Somalia. And 55% of the land is pastoral, 90% is residential land, 40% is forested, and 12% is suitable for agricultural production, certain cultivation. In 1990, the amount of cultivation land was estimated in 8.2 million hectares. In livestock production system in Somalia, as the livestock production system in Somalia, we can divide it into two types: nomadic livestock system, and we're gonna call pastoral, and settled livestock system, we're gonna call agropastoral, and model are used in Somalia. The main head is animals, species are camel, goat, sheep, cattle, with the number of livestock estimated is 7.2 million camels and 4.9 million heads of cattle, 11.5 million heads for sheep, and 11.6 million heads for goats. So we're going to see the next table of this. The number of animals in Somalia in million heads, you're going to see from 2014 to 2018, the number of animals, there was not different the numbers of animals. You're going to talk about the nomadic livestock system. And nomadic livestock system is divided those who migrate from herds to graze animals in pastoral and obtain all of their income from the animals and consume products themselves, although it is various dependent of the environmental conditions. And the next, we can talk a settled livestock system. And the farm field, it is a livestock activity, and there is carried out the family on residential basis, and they are suffers different types. It cannot be done a large herds in Somali herds or with a few animals. And while this product system was used in south and the north region of Somalia, and it has now spread all the regions. It is widespread even in arid and semi-arid unproductive regions because natural pastures are getting worse and become unsuitable for animal husbandry. So the presence and the composition of animal Somalia. And as you see, the north and the northeast and the center of country are largely raising camel, goats, sheep, and also a small of number of cattle. And on the eastern side, in this region, the number of cattle is high altitude, heavy rain, and there are also sheep, goats, and camels. And cattle farm in the middle shebel and the lower shebel are common settled livestock system. In the most of the Bokol Hedis, camels and goats are bred with an satellite livestock system, the most common in the satellite livestock system. Juba is the main cattle region, but also camels and goats are raised. The indigenous animal breeds of Somalia, goat, sheep, cattle, and camels. And the indigenous of Somalia, if you will know now, breeds, cattle, they the Somalia are found in four cattle breeds: Somali Brown, Surko breed, Gazara, and Dwara breed. Camels, all the camels in Somalia are single humped Arab camels. And camel, we can call a camels demeritas. Sheep is in Somalia are common black sheep, black head sheep. Sheep are dominant species. Goats, the Somali goats, and the Somali goats, and the species, Somali species, they are found in two goats, long eyed and short eyed. And wild variant livestock species include chicken. In Somalia, animals are grazed wild geographically. And in Somalia, Djibouti, Ethiopia, Kenya. As the nomadic livestock method is common, chicken farming does not occupy an important place in economically among the livestock branch. As you see in the Somali livestock export, you're gonna see a livestock export in 2014, and the next slide you're gonna see from 1994 to 2014, the Somali export. And most of the livestock trade covers in the Middle East country as the matter of the fact, historical, geographical, and the cultural tragedies provide livestock sales generally increased during the Ramadan and Hajj. Production. In Somali breeders primarily raised various animal species together for milk and meat production. In milk production, in fresh milk production in Somalia has been increasing steadily since until 1990. Camel milk is the most important in 2014. Somalia producing more than 1.1 million tons of camel milk, with a gross market is 1.65 million, according to the FAO status. Estimated that an income of approximately $2.7 billion obtained with the total milk production. The Somalia has been the largest producer of the camel milk in Africa. While it's the consumer prefers milk from cows, camels can produce more than milk from lower quality feed and then the other animal species, and the profit and the average yield is 2.5 and 3.5 liters per day. So we're going to talk meat production in Somalia. How is the meat production in Somalia? The amount of meat production in Somalia is increasing due to the increase in urbanization rate and the increase of in demand due to the population growth. Beef represents the largest share of the production in Somalia. The livestock irrigation in Somalia, due to the prevalence of nomadic livestock in Somalia, animal cannot find enough water, especially in dry seasons, summer and winter. When there no rain, therefore they have used water springing due to this period. In dry period, sheep, goats are irrigated 4 days, and cattle is in 2 days, cattle every day in 2 days, camel is once every day in 10, and even every harsh condition, the drinking of interval of camels is reducing one stall most. And so you're gonna see the agricultural trade sectors in Somalia. And Somali foreign trade is mostly agricultural product. Agricultural export is represented 93% of total export before the war yearly in 2010. And there has been a lot of change of the export figure in these 30 years. So Somali exported 198 million and received 2.23 billion in 2017, resulting in a negative trade balance in 2.4 billion in 2017. Somalia had a GDP of 7.05 billion and per capita GDP of 478 dollars. In the pre-reward period, the second largest exported item was fruit, mostly bananas, and mostly shipped to the Italy. Somalia has also exported grain, grapefruit and papaya. And in recent years, fruit exported has been limited to the some fastest major Gulf countries. And we're gonna come in conclusion and solution and suggestion. And the aim of the study is to estimate nomadic production strategy in Somalia, agriculture and animal husbandry. As the livestock production system in Somalia, nomadic livestock system, and certainly livestock are carried out. The livestock makes up 60% of income of the people of Somalia, and is one of the country that exported the large amount of livestock in the world. However, the problems of animal nutrition, especially in supply of feed. Solution and suggestion, mobility allows animals migrate from areas with less rainfall, green areas, or place most of will not be rich in the near of future. In addition, well-less farms should be established in each village to reduce migration, which is my cause and disease transmission among the animals. to reduce import, the government should be establish agricultural extension and in exercises for the encourage farmers to adopt new improvement farming methods for the world. Farmers should be attend training and workshops related to the crop production. And thank you for your attention, and thank you for bringing to the end of my presentation. Thank you for your attention and listening.
Thank you a lot to the speakers for such interesting presentations, the result of your researches. Are there any questions for the discussions? Maybe some questions for speakers? So thank you a lot. Our sessions is finished. Thank you for attention. Thank you for participating and for opportunity for participating in such a great Congress of Odessa State Agrarian University. Wishing you a good day and good finish of all Congress. Goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bye bye.
Thank you, Dalia.
Goodbye.